relatively more expensive compared to the fasting blood sugar or random blood sugar that is more common and much cheaper. So there's a significant decrease in the glycosylated hemoglobin, signifying that there is improvement in blood sugar control. And aside from this, saxagliptin has no significant effect on weight change or on lipid levels. So no beneficial or no harmful effects when it comes to lipids and weight neutral. Also, fasting plasma glucose is also decreased with saxagliptin, either as monotherapy, add-on therapy, or as combination with metformin. We will see in this graph here is the baseline. So all of the groups from the different trials had lower fasting plasma glucose levels in 24 weeks of intake of saxagliptin. In this slide, we will see that saxagliptin use, either as monotherapy, add-on therapy, or as initial combination with metformin, saxagliptin also decreases postprandial glucose levels. So here we also see that all of these are increased significantly. So when it comes to management of diabetes, since it involves multiple pathophysiologic mechanisms, it would be prudent that we address the problem using drugs with multiple mechanisms also, either as monotherapy or as combination therapy, to achieve better sugar, better glycemic control. So in the UK PDS study, which is a long-term study following up type 2 diabetic patients, it was noted that monotherapy, either with metformin or sulfonylurea or insulin, eventually all of the patients will not maintain blood sugar control. So all of them will eventually lose control of their diabetes. So this means, and also, despite different organizations recommending tighter glucose levels, majority of diabetic patients still fail to maintain their diabetes control, even in other much developed countries. So saxagliptin is one of the newer agents that we can add in the armamentarium of our treatment for diabetes. It can be used as an add-on to metformin, or as an initial combination with metformin, or as an add-on to sulfonylurea. And to present to you, I'll be presenting to you some cases wherein we can use saxagliptin in the management of our diabetes patients. So here we have a Johnny, a 48-year-old male, obese, with uncontrolled diabetes, with an A1C of 8.3%. He's a diabetic for 2 years and currently on metformin 500 milligrams 3 times a day. So with this profile and his diabetes being uncontrolled, will he benefit from increasing metformin therapy or adding other agents? So as an add-on to metformin, saxagliptin was 5 milligrams was noted to significantly reduce glycosylated hemoglobin in these patients. So if you will see in this graph, so glycosylated hemoglobin, there is a more significant decrease in the group of patients who received saxagliptin in addition to metformin, with a difference of about 0.7%. So based on previous studies, actually in the UK PDS, what they found out is that even a 1% reduction in glycosylated hemoglobin will significantly reduce microvascular and macrovascular complications in the long run. So a difference of a decrease in 0.7% will in the long term be confer somewhat a protective benefit for our diabetic patients. Postprandial glucose and fasting plasma glucose were likewise decreased with the addition of saxagliptin in metformin therapy. And more patients who received saxagliptin achieved control of their blood sugars during the end of this treatment period. They also compared addition of saxagliptin to metformin to addition of a sulfonylurea like Vivicide. So in this particular study, what they found out is that the saxagliptin plus metformin group and the Vivicide plus metformin group both produced significant improvement in diabetes control with regards to reduction in glycosylated hemoglobin. The sulfonylurea group had more decrease in fasting plasma sugar, but the saxagliptin group, being the saxagliptin being acting on the glucose-dependent insulin effect, there's a much greater decrease in postprandial glucose with the saxagliptin group. But all in all, the addition of saxagliptin or addition of a sulfonylurea is comparable when it comes to reduction in blood sugar levels. Yes. However, we know that for sulfonylurea, one of the limiting factors is the accompanying weight gain associated with sulfonylurea use, as well as more episodes of hypoglycemia with sulfonylurea. So, saxagliptin is weight neutral, and there is much less episode of hypoglycemia. So our second case is about Emma, a 52-year-old female who just complains of easy fatigability and was newly diagnosed to be diabetic with a fasting plasma glucose of 186 and an A1C of 9%. So she's also obese. So for this treatment-naive patient, will she benefit from monotherapy alone or combination therapy? So as we mentioned before, we can actually start with monotherapy or combination therapy depending on the patient profile. But in diabetic patients, because of the multiple mechanisms involved in its progression, it is better that we use drugs either in combination that will target the different problems associated with diabetes. So in this study, actually for this study in 2009, I think about a certain percentage of patients were Filipinos because one of the authors is actually one of the endocrinologists here in the Philippines. So in this study wherein they used saxagliptin in combination with metformin as initial therapy for newly diagnosed treatment-naive patients, they noted a 2.5% decrease in glycosylated hemoglobin from baseline, which is significantly better than the group who received metformin only. More patients in the saxagliptin group also got better control of their diabetes at 6 months follow-up compared to the metformin only group. The incidence of hypoglycemia with saxagliptin is 3.4% compared to 4% in the placebo, so it's similar. Fasting plasma glucose and postprandial glucose were also significantly better with the saxagliptin plus metformin combination group. And then they followed these patients for a total of about 18 months. And what we see is that the significant decrease in glycosylated hemoglobin or the control of diabetes was sustained during the long-term follow-up. So 2.3% decrease and 51% achieved a control of blood sugar. So for our third case, we have Marie, 65 years old female who has uncontrolled diabetes, inadequately controlled diabetes, when receiving levetiramine of 5 milligrams twice a day for the past 2 years. So a dose of levetiramine 5 milligrams twice a day is already about half maximum. So, will she benefit from increasing our dose of levetiramine, or can we add other medications? So, the main consideration for sulfonylurea, as I mentioned earlier, is that there is always the potential risk of hypoglycemia, particularly in elderly, debilitated, or malnourished patients. There's also more weight gain with sulfonylurea. So the patient is already over, I think, obese already. So do we want her to gain more weight? And in this study using saxagliptin, saxagliptin was added to a submaximal dose of sulfonylurea. So they used ribavirin in this study and compared this with another group of patients who received uptitrated ribavirin. So in the saxagliptin group and ribavirin group, there's a more significant decrease in glycosylated hemoglobin of 0.6% compared to the group who maintained ribavirin use and the dose was just increased. There was even a slight increase in the glycosylated hemoglobin. And more patients in the saxagliptin group likewise achieved better diabetic control compared to the placebo group who just received uptitrated ribavirin. Similarly to the previous studies, the fasting plasma glucose and the postprandial glucose were likewise lower in the group who received saxagliptin. So, I think those studies are evidence enough to show to you that additional saxagliptin in your management of diabetic patients can confer better diabetic control, whether as monotherapy, as add-on therapy, or as initial therapy in combination with metformin. We now go to the issue of safety and tolerability, which is